Hey guys, welcome to another Friday video. Today we're putting together a retro gaming PC from around 2005 using the AMD 939 platform. We've got a nice Asus SLI motherboard here with an Enforce chipset and also two video cards, one from Nvidia and another one from ATI. But the highlight of this video is definitely this processor. And here it is, the AMD Athlon 64 FX57. And back in 2005, AMD sold this processor for $1,031. And it was only a single core CPU. And at the time, you could already buy dual core processors for less. They were clocked a little bit slower, but in many applications, they were better value and outperformed this CPU. But for games, many games from that era can't take advantage of a second core. And for gaming, this CPU was really strong. It certainly outperformed all the Intel Pentium 4 CPUs, including the expensive Extreme Editions. So the Athlon 64 FX57 is for socket 939. We're running at 2.8 GHz, it's got 1 MB of level 2 cache, 104-watt TDP, and it launched in 2005 for a price of $1,031. What's really cool about the AMD 754 and 939 platform is that you can use modern CPU coolers. So this is a cooler you can buy from Amazon. It's the Near Silent 125 watts AMD thermal solution, which is basically the Rave cooler, but without the illuminated shroud. And yeah, does an excellent job at cooling this processor. Now we have to talk about main boards and plural, because I did run into quite a few issues. In many of my videos, it's normal to encounter a few teething issues, and usually they're easy to overcome, but I had lots of issues with main boards. So this one is a really nice motherboard, the A8N32SLI from Asus with an Enforce chipset main board. Firstly, the board did turn on, so that wasn't an issue. It also had the latest BIOS. But I had issues with the SATA controllers. So my usual method didn't work and I had to use a floppy drive and download the F6 AHCI SATA driver. But even then, after I installed Windows XP, but every time I installed the chipset driver, the machine would just not boot anymore. It would get stuck when loading Windows. And eventually I had to give up. I usually don't like doing that. I like to get to the bottom of things, but in this case, I just could not figure it out, so I had to move on to another mainboard. And this is the second mainboard I tried. So here I have replaced the chipset cooler. This is an Asus A8NE, and unfortunately this one wouldn't even post. So no screen, no post beep, couldn't get it to work, so I moved on to a third mainboard. And this was the third mainboard I tried. This is also an Asus. We've got an A8NVM. Also, some sort of an NVIDIA chipset on this mainboard. Same issue, unfortunately. Wouldn't post, black screen. So I had to move on to the fourth and final mainboard. Now, before we look at the final mainboard that I ended up using, just an observation. All three mainboards are from Asus and all three mainboards have a chipset from NVIDIA. Now, this is a very small sample size and it's hard to draw conclusions. But I've been doing this for a while and I've never really run into an issue with three mainboards not really working for me. So just an interesting observation. Eager to hear your input if you have used Asus mainboards with NVIDIA Enforce chipsets. What is your feedback about their reliability? This is the mainboard I ended up going with. It is the ASRock 939 Dual SATA 2. And that has a chipset from ULI, and this one worked flawless straight out of the gate. It posted and booted, and I didn't have any issues with the SATA controller either. It took a modern SATA 3 SSD straight out of the gate, so really nice mainboard to work with. So on this mainboard, we're running the latest BIOS from 2006, and to enter the BIOS, you press F2, and to access the boot menu, you press F11. As usually, I load the optimal BIOS defaults and then I do a few BIOS tweaks. For example, I disabled cool and quiet and also disabled the onboard Ethernet and audio controller. But apart from that, just a few resources. I usually disable things like serial, parallel, infrared port, game ports, and so on. But all the other settings, I just leave them at default. I have used this memory kit in the past, and usually I just load the BIOS defaults and make sure that it runs at 200 or 400 megahertz clock speed. But for this project, I actually looked at online and I found a data sheet, and it turns out that this is actually overclocking memory, but it doesn't say on the sticker, only on the data sheet. So what you have to do, it's actually rated at timings of 2336, but needs a voltage of 2.75. So I had a look in the BIOS, and there's a DRAM voltage option which I set to high. I then dialed in the timings to 2336 and also set the command rate to 1T timing, and that gave me a nice little boost across all games and benchmarks. And for this video, I decided to go with two video cards. Both are good representatives of 2005. So from NVIDIA, we've got the GeForce 7900 GTO, and from ATI, we've got the Radeon X1800 XT. Both video cards have 512 megabytes of VRAM. And yeah, I ran some benchmarks. So let's have a look how these two video cards compare. So first up, I ran 3D Mark, and yeah, not too much of a difference. In 03 and 05, the NVIDIA card is a little bit in front. Let's have a look at Doom 3. So here we can see the benchmark results across a couple of different resolutions, and there's not much of a difference. So here the CPU seems to be the bottleneck, and Doom 3 runs perfectly smooth at all of these resolutions. The detail setting is set to ultra. The other game I tested was Fear, and here we can see that the NVIDIA GeForce 7900 GTO is a little bit faster, especially once you crank up the resolution. It's a little bit in front of the Radeon, but not by much. And for sound, we're using a PCI sound card. This is a Sound Blaster X5. And yeah, I can highly recommend, if you're building a Windows XP retro gaming PC, do make sure you're using a Sound Blaster X5. A lot of these games support EAX, hardware accelerated 3D audio, especially with headphones. This is really an interesting experience. And if you play these old games on a modern Windows 10 machine, you will not get the same audio experience. So to install Windows XP, I like to use the easy to boot project to install Windows XP off a USB flash drive. So I went ahead and downloaded the latest version of easy to boot, but it just didn't work. And it turns out that the newer versions don't seem to work with XP anymore. So I had to look a little bit around online and found an older version. So I ended up using version 1.b5, and that one works perfectly fine with Windows XP. Another thing I learned, I believe one of you left a comment, on this main board, the easy to boot will load a USB 1 driver, so it takes a long time to load. All you have to do is, when you see the easy to boot screen, hold down the shift key and it will load a grub for DOS USB 2.0 driver, and suddenly the installation happens a lot faster. And after Windows XP is installed, we need some drivers. I like using the Snappy Driver Installer Origin project, which identifies all the components and then installs the latest drivers. I usually untick the video card and also the sound card, because I've got I want to manually control which driver version I'm installing. But yeah, it finds everything else automatically, especially the ULI AGP driver, for example. For the graphics card, for the NVIDIA card, we're using driver version 30783. And for the sound card, we're using the Daniel K X5 Support Pack 4.0. And not sure if I wrote down the graphics driver for the Radeon. Yes, I did. We're using the 10.2 Catalyst for the X1800 XT. And you also have to install the .NET Framework 2.0 to get the Catalyst Control Center up and running. And now let's have a look at some games. So first I started with the GeForce, with the 7900 GTO. And the first game I tried, Far Cry, running at 1280 by 1024. The performance is okay, but we can see a texture bug where the textures turn into some sort of a snowy mess. Not quite sure what's going on, but this is definitely some sort of a driver bug. And that was the reason why I then later switched over to the Radeon card, because I wanted to see how good Far Cry runs. The next game I checked out was Half-Life 2. We're running at 1280x1024. It runs well, but I did notice a few skips and pauses here and there. That could be because this processor only has a single core. Need for Speed Underground also runs perfectly fine. We're running at 1280x1024. I did go into the graphics options and I turned on motion blur and all the effects, and it's locked at 60 FPS. And finally, the last game I tried on the GeForce, the 7900 GTO, is Painkiller. 1280x1024, all details maxed out and runs silky smooth. And then I switched over to the Radeon X1800 XT, and Far Cry now works without any issues. I did dial down the details a little bit too high on Ultra. The performance is just not up to scratch, and I do believe it's still the processor that's holding this game back a little bit. But with high details, this is a very smooth experience for sure. Call of Duty is next. This is an older game. It runs perfectly fine at 100 plus FPS. Once again, running at 1280x1024 with all the details maxed out. Halo is next. 100 plus FPS at 1280x1024. Really nice looking game and perfectly well playable on the AMD Athlon 64 FX57. Splinter Cell Chaos Theory is next, my absolute favorite Splinter Cell game. We're using 1280x1024, and yeah, sometimes it does dip below 60 FPS, but this is a game where it probably doesn't matter too much. It's a stealth game, not twitchy. You have a, yeah, you can take your time, so shouldn't be an issue. But still, this machine or the video card, not quite powerful enough to run this game at 60 FPS locked. And the last game I tried out was Prince of Persia Sands of Time. This game didn't support the 1280x1024, but we can test 1280x960. I had to disable the VSync option, which was turned on by default, and we're getting well over 100 FPS and silky smooth experience. So guys, that was a look at the Athlon 64 FX57 running at 2.8 GHz. And at the time, which was 2005, so 15 years ago, AMD charged over $1,000 for the CPU. So it was an absolute enthusiast product. And the performance is outstanding, but it launched at a time where you could get a dual core processor for significantly less. Sure, the clock speed wasn't that high. The Athlon 64 FX57 runs at 2.8 GHz. So you could get a dual core processor that maybe runs at 2.2 or 2.4, and with a bit of overclocking, you would get close to the 2.8, and then games that can take advantage of the second core will run maybe a little bit better, but mostly productivity software would run better. But also games would let you do something in the background, like your operating system, or maybe playing MP3 file or something like that. So it opened a lot of doors to using your computer in different ways and also having a smoother, more responsive computing experience. Yeah, so let's talk about all the parts. Mainboard, that was an interesting one. So Asus and Enforce chipsets, yeah, looks like I'm put off. I'm not quite sure what I'm gonna do with these boards. I feel like just throwing them out because yeah, I lost quite a bit of time on mucking around with mainboards. It's a real pain having to swap out a mainboard. Yeah. And yeah, I gotta say, really happy with ASRock. In general, I've been using a lot of ASRock mainboards and they usually always work fine. So good personal account, at least in terms of reliability. The ULI chipset also seems to have decent performance. It supports dual channel memory. The BIOS has enough options to use our overclocking RAM. So we had to raise the voltage and then dial in the timings manually. The SATA controllers are also compatible with modern SATA 3 SSDs. That was also very nice to see. We have PCI Express, AGP and PCI slots on this mainboard. So that's one of the highlights. For sound, definitely get a Sound Blaster X5. Windows XP is just that little bit better when you have games that use the EAX API, and especially if you use headphones, you get some really cool 3D effects. With the video card, pick your poison. You can go with a GeForce or Radeon, lots of different cards from this era. Both of these cards have 512 megabytes of VRAM and both have a dual slot cooling solution. The NVIDIA card is a little bit quieter and also performed a little bit better, but the Radeon card does better, I believe, in Far Cry, and it runs Far Cry without any issues. With the NVIDIA card, you have to try some older drivers to get Far Cry to run without any graphical issues. With the 939 socket, it's nice to see that you can use modern AMD coolers, even Tau coolers, and yeah, that just fit onto the mainboard. That's really nice. It's such a different experience with compared to like Intel, where you have 775 and then 1150X and all those different CPU coolers that are not compatible, and then going back to the Pentium 4, which had the 478. So that's a big mess, whereas this wonderful 125-watt modern AMD box cooler I can use with a huge range of AMD legacy products going back all the way to 2005. And yep, again, SSD in Windows XP, it does work. Don't be too alarmed about wear and tear and no trim support. Most SSDs these days have some sort of garbage collection integrated and shouldn't be an issue. A good tip is not filling them up all the way, maybe 2/3 or something like that. And that gives the SSD enough empty flash capacity to use for garbage collection. And to make your retro project easier, do take note of these two projects. So easy to boot to install Windows XP off a USB flash drive, and then the Snappy Driver Installer to quickly identify and install the drivers for all your components. I usually skip the sound and the video drivers. I like installing them manually to not have any issues. So guys, there you have it. What a nice machine from 2005. Do let me know, what do you think about this era? Which way did you go? Pentium 4 or Athlon 64? And also, which video card? Did you have a GeForce or an ATR Radeon? Why did you go for either? Do share your thoughts down below in the comments. I read every comment. I might not reply, but I do read every comment. And do let me know, what do you want to see in future video projects? And that's it, guys. Thank you so much for watching. If you found the video interesting and you want to see more content like this, be sure to subscribe, leave a comment, share the video with your friends, give it a like, and I shall see you soon with another one.